Hey YouTube, this is Jaden coming at you from Team Shadow Strike, and in this deck video, I'll be bringing you another deck profile. This one specifically will be covering the Savas deck profile that I've been promising you guys. Finally got, the last cards that I needed to finish it, and been playtesting the deck, and it has actually been doing phenomenal. The deck is actually extremely annoying for its ability to chain attack while being able to take units off your opponent's board. And the finishers that this deck has is absolutely phenomenal. Before I get into this deck profile, I want to give a shout out to someone very, very special to me in my life. And this deck profile is dedicated to him. I don't know where I'd be without this person. He has done so much for me in my personal life, and I love him to death. He is easily one of the best people I've ever known. So thank you very much to that person, and they'll know who they are. So anyway, this deck profile is dedicated to him, and without further ado, we're just gonna jump straight into this. So for the starting Vanguard, it is Kelpie Rider Metros. So Metros is a very good starter for this deck. In case you don't know, his ability is Generation Break 1, Wave 3 or more. So Wave 3 being, Attack 3 or higher. when your Vanguard attacks, if you have a Grade 3 or greater Vanguard with Savas in its card name, you may pay the cost. If you do, search your deck for up to one Grade 3 card with Savas in its card name from your deck, call it to a rear guard circle, shuffle your deck, and at the end of that turn, return that unit to your hand. So it's kind of like Chronodran for Gear Chronicle. It lets you search out Savas, place it on the field, get another attack off, and then in the end phase, that Savas is going to bounce to your hand, and you can either use that Savas next turn to ride if you rode your other grade 3 in the deck, or you can use it to pay for a stride later on. So, and plus it's just another card in the hand, and that's always nice to have. The other option for a starter, and I was able to get this card at my locals Saturday, and that is Bubble Edge Draco Kid. This is an old starter. This came back out in BT13, like two and a half, maybe longer years ago. I have been hunting this card because for whatever reason, I couldn't find any in the millions of cards that I have. I'm probably going to do a couple of playtest games and try this, because this card is good. In case you don't know, I'll just read him real fast. Bubble Edge Draco Kid, he has the Forerunner ability, but the other skill, you place him into the soul and you choose... You place him into your soul if you have an Aqua Force Vanguard, which obviously you will in this deck. Choose one of your Aqua Force units, and until the end of turn, that unit gets... When this unit attacks a Vanguard, if it is the fourth battle of that turn or more, draw a card. So if you're... going to use it on a turn where you're going to attack and you have a unit that's going to attack multiple times, if it's the fourth and higher for each attack that unit makes, he's going to gain, you're going to get to draw an additional card. So I might play test this and see if I like this better. This deck is built for my friend, so it is technically his deck, but so he'll have both of these to decide whichever one works best for him. But I personally, I don't really see the a better option here. They're both good because they both give you something in return. You're going to one way or the other plus one way or the other. So there's really no wrong answer here. It's really player preference in this case. Me personally, I'm going to playtest this, but I don't know which one I'd go with if I were playing the deck. But it is either one would be a solid option. But for right now, I've been playtesting Metros, and he's worked out really well. So, next we play four Kelpie Rider Petros. I think that Petros. This is our critical trigger that's exclusive to Savas. Whenever Savas attacks, and this is on the field, you can place this in the soul of Savas. Savas is going to gain 5,000 power and then draw another card. You draw another card. So it's essentially a Heart Thump Worker clone. So really, really good. Next, we play four copies of Blue Storm Marine General Despina. So this might give away the other grade 3 in the deck if you've seen this card and you know what this card does. So anyway, well, maybe not the specific one, but you'll know what it is. Her ability is when this unit boosts your Vanguard with Maelstrom and its card name, if it is the fourth battle of that turn or more, your opponent cannot call grade zero cards from their hand to the Guardian Circle, and at the end of the battle, return this unit to your deck and shuffle it. So it is a trigger that goes back to your deck so that you can recycle it and possibly check it again. So it's a really good trigger. So 8 crits. Next, we play 4 copies of Battle Siren Malika. This is for our draw trigger. So Margul clone, basically, whenever you can call her to the field, place her into the soul, and give +3k away. You can use this to pump up any unit on your field, especially if you're going to be going in for multiple attacks. So that's why you play Malika. And plus, drawing is always something that really helps Aqua Force maintain its push. And then, obviously, we're playing our 4 heal triggers because we need them for G-Guards, and we're good players, so we always play heal triggers. So 8 crits, 4 draws, 4 heals. I will say real quickly, the new stand trigger that came out in set 9, the Dolphin, I can't remember his name, but he's the one that if he attacks on wave 2 or more, he becomes an 11k attacker, and then he goes back to the deck and you draw a card. That card is not bad, it's just... I did not know how I wanted to fit it in. I like this trigger lineup. I thought about cutting one Dispenia for him, but I didn't really see it as a needed card. If you want to play stands in this deck, it's not a bad option. I just prefer going more aggressive, and you stand enough in this deck as it is. So I feel that you can just leave the standing to all the effects that you have floating in the deck, and then just use your triggers to push for more damage and more advantage. So that's my reason behind that. So the stand, like I said, he is good, but it's just not needed. Next, we play 4 copies of Kelpie Rider Plato. Kelpie Rider Plato is our G Guard, or not G Guardian, our Perfect RG that lets us unflip damage. You do counterblast a fair amount in this deck. So it is nice to have the option because Aqua Force will need that. We'll need counterblasts every now and then. So I know some players, when they're playing Savas, they like the wave Perfect Guard better. But I prefer the ability to unflip. That's just me. And plus, I don't have the wave Perfect Guards. But either way, even if I did have them, I mean, I probably would still test them, but this deck can counterblast pretty heavily at times. And it's just safer to go with a safer option. For Kelpie Rider Nikki. Kelpie Rider Nikki is our stride fodder that you can pitch and stride off of, and you can also use this to search out your Savas, because it is the unit that you're generally wanting to ride most times. But I only play 7 grade 3s in this deck, so that's why I max out on the stride fodder. Next, we play 4 copies of Battle Siren Melania. This by far is the best grade 1 in this deck. This card puts in so much work, especially in the clutch. Her ability is Generation Break 1, wave 3rd time or more, so 3rd attack or higher. Whenever this unit attacks a Vanguard, if you have a grade 3 or greater Vanguard with Savas in its card name, you may counterblast 1. If you do, draw a card, and she gets +5,000 power until end of battle. So she can be in your front row, and she can attack for 12, plus whatever, if you have a boost for it or not, and you can draw a card draw a card as well. And if that weren't good enough, she also has the resist ability. So it is really good to have that because Aqua Force needs boosters for some units. And if you stick it in the front row and you're playing against Kagero, Gear Chronicle, or Narukami, they can't destroy it. They can't destroy it and blow it up, and they can't rewind it for those 3 G-Guardians, like the rewinding one for Gear Chronicle Head Around. They can't blast it with Griffin in Kagero, and they can't use Bulwark Dragon in Narukami to retire it. So it's this is a good card to have and max out on. The other grade 1 is I play 2 copies of Battle Siren Stacia. I originally was going to go 3 Melania and 3 Stacia, but Melania, I'm sorry. This card is just too good not to max out on. I am in love with this card. It puts in so much work. It's a really good card to use when you're going into Commander Savas as your unit to attack from the back row, because she's going to gain 5k from Commander Savas and then 5k off her own skill, so she can attack for 17 from the back row and draw you a card. So there's really... she's just too good not to play four of them, sorry. But if you do go three Melania, three Stacia, I do get it. Oh, and just in case you don't know, Stacia, her skill is Generation Break 1. During your turn, this unit gets the ability. This unit can attack from the back row and auto skill whenever this unit attacks. If this unit is attacking from your back row, it gets plus 3,000 power. So if she's sitting back here as a booster, instead of boosting with her that turn, you can send her out a rear guard and go head-to-head for 9. So it puts your opponent in an awkward position. That either says, okay, either drop a shield to protect this rear guard now or do it later. And plus it gets your attack count up so she can count as one. There have been times where I literally have two of these in the back, both of them in the back row, and you can go 9 at one rear guard, 9 at the other rear guard, and that's two attacks already for your attack count whenever you're going into Wailing Savas or you're just trying to push out as much attacks as you can. You know, doing what Aqua Force does best. Grade 2s. First, four copies of Battle Siren Adelaide, I think is how you say her name. Battle Siren Adelaide, her ability is Generation Break 1. Whenever this unit is placed on the rearguard circle, you may, and you have a Grade 3 or greater Vanguard with Savas in its card name, you may pay the cost of Counterblast 1 and Soul Blast 1. If you do, until end of turn, this unit gets plus 2,000 power and the auto skill. At the end of the battle that this unit attacked a Vanguard, you can restand this unit. So the turn she's called, she attacks twice. She's really good because you can use her to get that extra attack. You can use her as your card with Commander Savas to attack from the back row, and she'll be able to attack twice. So she'll be 16 once you power up with Commander's skill. So really, really, really good card. Next, we play four copies of Magnum Assault. Magnum Assault has been out for a while. He came out in the Aqua Force trial deck, and he's still probably a staple in almost any Aqua Force deck. Generation Break 1, at the end of the battle that this unit attacked a Vanguard, if he was boosted during the battle, you can counterblast 1. If you do, stand this unit, and he gives plus 2,000 power. So he can attack twice. So you can attack with him. Like, if you have a boost back here, he can attack for, like, if you have Melania behind him, 9 and 7, he'll be 16 at the Vanguard, and then you can counterblast 1 and stand him back up, and he's 11. So if your opponent didn't damage trigger, he can attack him, the Vanguard, again. And even if he did a damage trigger, you can go after a rear guard for 11, or if you want to go after a rear guard, you can. The point is he gets two attacks off, and that will help out, get, because this deck needs to be able to hit at least four attacks a turn in order to kick off all their skills and to abuse the deck the right way. Okay, for the last grade two, I'm probably going to catch a little bit of flack for this, but I will explain my choice. I'll explain why. And that is four copies of Tidal Assault. Now, if you've been watching my channel for a while, you know the controversy surrounding this card and my team. My teammate Sam, he played Aqua Force when we qualified for Nationals. And when we qualified for Nationals, and I showed off his deck profile, because I posted them when we were in our hotel room that night, after we came back from dinner after the tournament, and it hadn't been 20 freaking minutes, and I must have gotten 4 or 5 comments. Where's Tidal Assault? Where's Tidal Assault? Why aren't you playing Tidal Assault? Oh my god, where are you playing Tidal Assault? And we eventually made a video about it, because it was like, guys, Tidal Assault is a good card. Okay, whoa, back up. Tidal Assault is the best situational card in the that you could make a case that it is the best situational card in the game. And let me explain what I mean by that. In the early game, when both you and your opponent are floating around grade 1 and grade 2, he is really good because you can attack with him for 9, have a boost behind him, stand him back up, and then attack again. And if your opponent isn't damage triggering, you're damaging them a lot if they're not guarding in the early stages of the game. The And with your strides, he is okay. Commander Savas, he's okay. If you want to use him as the unit that attacks in the back row. He's really good on turns with Lambros, because he is going, you can send him to attack a rearguard, he's going to restand and go to 19 with Lambros' skill, and then he can attack two more times after that, because his skill only activates if you attack the vanguard. But if you attack a rearguard, it can't activate, so that way when he restands later, you can still use that skill. So, and obviously, just for argument's sake, after he attacks the vanguard, you may lower his attack by 5,000 and restand him. The reason he is not as good as people make this card seem is because if your opponent knows what they're doing and either they damage check or they know how to work around this card, he becomes instantly worthless. Now, Lambros turns, he's amazing. The reason he's in here and the reason that I finally am using him is because of Wailing Savas. Because Wailing Savas, even if you attack your opponent first with 16, and then you stand him back up and just attack for 4. Obviously, it's not going to hit your opponent's vanguard, but it's another attack count. Now, since you're having Wailing Savas, just by wasting that one attack, well, not wasting, you're technically still using the attack, but Wailing Savas is going to gain another 5,000 out of that, and I'll get into the strides later, but that is why I'm okay with using this card now. In the early game, it is extremely good if you can rush your opponent down with it. The mid game, he loses a lot of his steam. But then when you go into Lambros, he becomes good again. He is maybe not the best, but he is one of the best situational cards in the game. And he is good at what he does if everything falls into place. And that is why I'm okay using this card. I'm probably going to get some hate in the comment section for playing this card for everything I've said about it. And that's fine. This card is good. It is not the ace card that everyone thinks it is. That's my opinion, and I'm not going to get into it anymore because me and Sam have probably defended that deck profile thousands of times, and there was a couple of times where I may have responded in videos or comments and I got real angry. The reason I got real angry is because Sam is one of my closest friends, and my biggest pet peeve in the world, you can say whatever you want about me, but the second you start targeting my friends and family, and Sam's been my friend for so long, he's practically he is my family. And when people started saying that he was an idiot, he was horrible, his deck was terrible, he placed third at fucking nationals and they said his deck was horrible. I mean, third at regionals to qualify for nationals and they said his deck was horrible. That is what ticked me off. Because it's just like, he is my friend, he is my teammate, and you're attacking him because his opinion does not match yours. And that's not fair to him. And I agree with everything he said about this card. It is here mainly as a tool. And, you know, I still believe everything in the videos that we said about this card. But the deck has changed a little bit, and now I find enough reason to use him. But this, at least this way now, all your grade 2 units give you the ability to get you that fourth attack. That is why that this works now. So this is my grade 2 lineup, and this is the best lineup that I think that you can have in a Savas deck. And that is all I'm going to say. If anybody asks me any question in the comment section about Tidal Assault or says anything, I promise I will not respond. I will not do it. I am tired of getting into that argument, but that is literally my last word on it. So hopefully you guys will respect that. I know some people were very respectful of it, of Sam's choices. I'm not saying everybody jumped on him, but for the people who did, and you know who you are, and I know who you are, I do not appreciate that, and not one of them who was extremely rude to Sam ever apologized, and that is what's wrong. We have had this discussion on my channel many a times. Just because someone's deck does not match your idea of how the deck should be built, it does not mean that the deck is bad, and it does not mean that their opinion is any less valid than yours. I'm going to get more into a discussion about that later, but about another video that I want to do. But anyhow, just because someone's deck does not match the way you'd build it, it does not mean it's wrong. Just please be respectful of that. That is something that I try to preach on this channel a lot, and not to be a preacher, because I can't stand being preached at myself, but it is a good lesson to learn, and it's one I think everyone should have and be reminded of, that it is important to respect other people's opinions. So, anyway, back to the deck. Next is we're playing four copies of our main man, the one who surpasses the storm, Savas. So I was able to get one of these for who this deck's for, and I'm very happy for that, because this art of Savas is absolutely gorgeous, and I want to try and get a full play set of him if that's possible. But anyway, Savas is Generation Break 2. If he attacks on the fourth battle or more, he gains +1 crit, and your opponent can't use grade zeros to guard his attack. And then he has the stride skill that lets him pick off a rear guard. Destroy a rear guard, I guess I should say. And what's also really nice about Savas that a lot of people really never bring up, it's the fact that when the very first set of stride breaks came out, Chronojet, Asha, Altamile, Vanquisher, you know, all of these that were the very first stride breaks, Savas was one that didn't cost a thing. And that's really nice. It does not have a counterblast. It's just whenever a unit attacks on the fourth battle of the turn, it triggers. So it's really good. So that's just something not a whole lot of people ever bring light to that I think deserves to be said. And then for the last grade three, we are playing three copies of Blue Storm Karma Dragon Maelstrom Reverse. Now, you might be asking, I debated about it for a long time when I was trying to figure out what the other grade 3 to place in this deck is, and I came down to Glory Maelstrom or Maelstrom Reverse. Now, Glory Maelstrom, if you're at 5 damage, you can use his ultimate break, and he becomes, he gets +5,000 power, +1 crit, and he can attack the Vanguard, and your opponent cannot use grade 1 or higher units to guard the attack. The problem with him now is G-Guardians are a thing. So if your opponent has a heal trigger in their hand, they can pitch that heal trigger, and they're going to be able to guard Maelstrom, Glory Maelstrom real easy. Now you might be saying, well, they'll be able to guard this just as easy. That is right, because whenever he attacks, let me read him real quick. Limit Break 4, counterblast 1 and choose one of your rear guards, rest it, and lock it. When this unit attacks a Vanguard, if it is the fourth battle of that turn or more, you may pay the cost. If you do until the end of that battle, this unit gets +5,000 power and +1 critical. And the auto skill, at the end of the battle that this unit attacked, if the attack did not hit, keep that in mind, it's if it does not hit, during that battle, draw a card and choose a card on your opponent's rear guard and retire it. The reason I like this better is because if for a lot of reasons. One, if your opponent does not let this hit, you aren't just oh well. Because if Glory doesn't hit, it's just oh well. This, if it doesn't hit, you're popping a rear guard and you're drawing an additional card. So you're essentially getting three cards to your hand, the same you would in a triple drive if you strode. Another reason I like this, if your opponent is playing a rush deck and they try not to ride grade 3 and they just want to just attack, tack, 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 because the 7 Seas deck, believe it or not, guys, is still a thing. Even with that starter hit to 1, I have a very good friend who has made the deck still very much a thing. Plus, there are other decks out there that will stall a turn or two just to slow you down. This will give you a way to still punish them for not riding grade 3 because you're attacking for 16 plus a crit. And at a 9K Vanguard, they have to drop 15K for a 2-pass. And that, you know, that can get dangerous pretty quick. Another reason that Tidal Assault is in this deck is because if your opponent is playing that game, you can't use Battle Siren Adelaide or Magnum Assault yet because they're both Generation Break 1 units, and you have to stride once before you can even have access to these. So Tidal Assault can come in handy when you want to do this. And also, you might be saying, well, what about the cards in the deck like Melania or your Savas crit that needs a Savas Vanguard in order to activate. Well, you play a lot of cards in your G-Zone that are Savas strides, and when you stride onto the Maelstrom, they still technically have a Savas name, so they will still activate. So this just makes more sense to me. Now, if you play Glory, that's fine. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying this gives you something, assuming they're going to guard it. Because when you attack at them for 16 plus a crit, they're going to either lay down 2 to pass, or they're going to perfect guard it. And in that case, at least by them doing that, you're popping something on their field, and you get to draw out of it. So it you get more back for assuming what your opponent is most likely going to do. So, and you can bump this up to 4. I only play 7 grade 3s in this deck. And to be real honest, I really don't mind riding either one of these first. Because even if I ride Maelstrom and I want to ride Savas later, Mitros can still activate because your first stride is usually going to be Commander Savas, and you'd be able to search Savas out anyway and then ride it the next turn anyway. So you can, it doesn't really matter which one you ride first. There are some matches actually that I prefer to ride one over the other, but it's this to me makes more sense. Another grade 3 lineup that I had considered is you play 4 Savas, you play 2 copies of the new grade 3 from set 9 that when he attacks, you counterblast 1, he restands and he becomes 13, and then he can attack again. He's basically another Tidal Assault, another Magnum Assault. And then play 2 copies of Stormrider Diamantes, which is a card way back from when Aquaforce was originally introduced in the original set 8. But the problem with playing him is I am fearful of drawing Diamantes and not drawing my Kelpie Rider Nikki or another grade 3 to ride. And if you ride that grade 3 that only has 9,000 power, true, he gets 2,000 power when he's attacking for the first time and he becomes 11. But if you get stuck with that, you're just kind of in trouble. So this just is the safer, more consistent option, and that's why I went with this lineup. You can also use... what's his face? I can't remember his name, guys, but I know you'll know what I'm talking about. The grade 3 that gives your front row resist. He is a good option as well. That's going to bug the crap out of me. But the grade 3 that gives your entire front row resist, that's good. But what's stupid about that is if you stride onto him, that skill goes away. So if you're playing against Kagero or Narukami, they're still going to be able to blast your units in the front row with their G-Guardians, or Gear Chronicle will be able to rewind them. So it's only really good during their turn. Now, if the format was like littered with Chaos Breaker, then it's a better option. But Chaos Breaker, in my honest opinion, has fallen a little bit out of the meta picture. Not fallen completely out of the picture, but he is not as around anymore that I've seen. God, it's going to drive me insane. But if for whatever reason at your locals or your area there's a lot of Link Joker running around, then Skyros, that's his name. If there's a lot of Link Joker running around in your area, then Skyros might be a good option for you. But me personally, this works well. So that is the main deck. Next for the G-Zone, we play 4 copies of Storm Dominator Commander Savas. I have 2 copies of each art, the Generation Rare and the reprint. I want to get 2 more copies of this Generation Rare eventually. The reason I didn't build Savas when he started getting his first main support when he came out in the clan booster for Aquaforce is because this card was like, it was north of like $40. Like, it was like, I saw this card selling at regionals for even 50 plus, and you know, it just was like $200 for a playset of him. It's like, uh-uh. When he got the reprint, I decided I was going to build this, and the person this deck's for really likes the color blue, and you don't get much more bluer than Savas and Aquaforce, right? This card has since dropped way down in price. It's much more reasonable now, and I want to get 2 more copies of the prettier art. But Commander Savas is your first stride every single time. I don't want to say every single time, but he really, really kind of is. Choose a face-down copy of Commander Savas and flip it face-up. Choose one of your rear guards until end of turn. It gets plus 5,000 power, and the skill of this unit can attack from the back row. And until end of turn, it also gets the skill of wave Generation Break 3 Vanguard skill, wave fourth time only. When your unit attacks a Vanguard, choose three of your opponent's rear guards. Your opponent chooses one rear guard from among the three and then retires it. So it gives, it basically re-gives him the stride skill. So, and by having two, I can, it, I normally rearrange it this way so I can ride the pretty one and then flip the reprint. But, for those of you who want to play Savas, you know, playing four that you can get Commander Savas is really, really cheap now. They gave, this was another card that desperately needed a reprint, like Next Stage, because when Next Stage was, came out for Gear Chronicle, he was, I think he was up to $70 at one point, $70 or $80 for Chrono Dragon Next Stage. Me, fortunately, I pulled all my Next Stages and traded for them. Well, no way. I didn't. I only traded for one of my Next Stage. The other three I pulled. I was very lucky. So, but this deck is now a lot more cost efficient. You can build this deck now for a lot less than what it would have been if this card didn't get reprinted. And the deck really needs four copies of this card. Next, we play two copies of the main reason actually that I wanted to build this deck, and that is the new Stride for Aqua Force, and it is Storm of Lament, Wailing Savas, one of the generation rares from the new from set 9. This card is absolutely beautiful. It, when I saw this card, it instantly made me think of the person who this deck's for, and that's why I chose to build it for him. This card is absolutely insane. It is the powerhouse unit that Aqua Force was looking for, and it's an alternative finisher. Generation Break 3. Whenever this unit attacks, for each battle that a rearguard attacked during this turn, your opponent chooses one of his or her rearguards and retires it. So, if you attack with your rearguards four times and then you attack with him for the fifth, you're going to retire four rearguards on your opponent's field, and that is just devastating. If you're playing against Saint Guard or any of the Paladin decks, that is game-changing and can cripple them. That can cripple a lot of decks, actually. It would hurt Angel Feather, it'd hurt any of the Paladins, it would hurt any of the control decks, or... usually, Gear Chronicle isn't going to have that many units on their field during the during your turn if they play the Time Leap variant, that is. But it is an option to have to basically wipe their field, which is really, really nice. And then the other skill, Generation Break 2, wave third time or more, so the third attack or higher. When this unit attacks, you can counterblast one. If you do, until the end of the battle, this unit gets plus 5,000 power for each battle that a rearguard attacked during this turn, and your opponent cannot call grade ones from the hand to the guardian circle. So if you attack four times with rearguards before you attack with him, he's going to be at 26 already because he's a stride. He's going to then gain an additional 20,000 power. He goes from 26 to 46, and your opponent cannot guard with grade ones, meaning they can't use their perfect guard on this. So they have to manually guard this with G guardians and intercepts and from their hand. Now, here's also why Maelstrom is nice. If you ride Maelstrom and you stride onto Wailing Savas, and you happen to have Dyspnea behind him, and you attack the critical trigger for that I said at the beginning of this, and you attack, and it's the fourth battle of that turn or more, he's also going to gain Dyspnea's effect, which prevents them from guarding with grade zeros. In that case, then, your opponent will only be able to use G Guardians and Intercepts in order to guard this, and that makes this thing a nightmare to deal with if he is swinging somewhere in the high 40s, or even the low 50s. That is absolutely insane. And your opponent is going to most likely have to take the attack. And if they are at 5 damage, that wins the game. Assuming, of course, they don't... excluding the idea if they death heal. But that is amazing. This card alone is what made me want to build this deck. It is absolutely a game changer for Aqua Force in general. And the fact that it does not need a Savas Heart even makes it better. Next, we play four copies of Marine General of Heavenly Silk, Lambros. Everybody knows Lambros. This card's been around since set two. It also got a reprint in the Revival collection. Both of these were very much needed reprints for Aqua Force, because Aqua Force was a pretty expensive deck to build, because Lambros was 30 apiece. This card at one time was, you know, 40, 50 apiece, and it was extremely not budget friendly to build this deck. These two cards getting reprints, it was a very good thing, because it makes the deck more affordable, and I don't like card games that become who has the biggest wallet. It should be more about skill. But Lambros, just for memory's sake, let's read Lambros. So when this unit attacks a Vanguard, if it is the fourth battle of that turn or more, you may choose a face-down copy of Lambros in your G-Zone and turn it face-up. If you do, choose two of your rearguards and stand them. Then if the number of cards in your G-Zone is face-up is two or more, the units that were stood with this effect gain 10,000 power. So, and the nice thing about this card is he does not cost any counterblast, so you can use him if you're running out of counterblast. And you can use this also to just take a lot of cards out of your opponent's hand. Lambros is really good at that. These three cards, what makes this deck so good is most decks normally have one or two finishers. You can use all three of these as finishers. They are all good options. For the last stride is I play one copy of Marine General of Heavenly Silk, Christos. His ability, wave first time only, so you must attack with him first. Which is good, because you don't play stands in this deck. Whenever this unit attacks a Vanguard, you may pay the cost of counterblast 1. If you do, all of your rear guards in the front row get plus 2,000 power, and the skill of Wade third or fourth time. So if on the third or fourth attack of the turn, when their attacks hit, you get to draw one card. So you can use him to refuel your hand if your opponent's hand is a little small. But if your opponent's hand is really small, chances are you're going to go to Lambros. But if Lambros isn't an option because you can't get that fourth attack off, Christos is a really good backup. Next, for G-Guardians, we're playing two copies of Guard Leader of Sky and Water, Floatia. Her ability is, if she is used during the first or second attack on your opponent's turn, she gains 5,000 power and shield, so she becomes a 20k shield. Not bad. And then we have two copies of Blue Storm Deterrence Dragon, Ice Barrier Dragon. So Ice Barrier Dragon, his ability is wave first or wave four. So either on the first attack or the fourth attack on your opponent's turn, when this unit is placed on the Guardian Circle, it gets plus 10,000 power. So he becomes a 25k shield. What this tells me is the next G-Guardian that Aqua Force gets is probably going to be on the third attack. And then this one proxy here is for Dismal. I still need to get another copy of Dismal for this deck, because at the moment I only have one. And it's not that the card is really that expensive, it's just hard to find. Because the fighter collection that this thing came in is just a freaking nightmare to find. The only other thing that I would probably do for this deck is I would probably cut one Floatia and one Deterrence and put in maybe one Screw, the Cray Elemental G-Guardian, where you discard a card and he gains 10,000 power and shield, because he's a little more flexible than this, and then maybe make one of these Seabreeze. Probably definitely on the Seabreeze. I would probably drop this for Seabreeze. Those are just a couple other ideas. But anyway, guys, that is the deck. So, anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed this deck profile. It was a little bit longer than I intended, but there was a lot of discussion for this deck that I wanted to get into, and a lot of reasons for cards and things like that. For the person who this video and the deck is dedicated to, I hope you really enjoy what you see. I can't wait to give this to you. But anyway, in the comment section below, tell me, what did you think of the deck? What are your thoughts on Savas? If you have any suggestions, please leave them down below. Always love to hear what you have to say. So anyway, guys, thank you very much for watching, and thank you for your continued support of the channel, and just being awesome, I guess. So anyway, guys, I hope you all are doing well, and I, once again, if you have any other suggestions for videos, please leave them down below, and I'll be happy to do what I can. So anyway, guys, thank you very much for watching. Make sure you leave a like, comment, subscribe, thumbs up this video, share it with your friends, and I'll see you next time.